There is no solo Christianity. We are not meant to journey the Christian life alone. We do it together.
This is my story. This is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. Living Truth.
This is Living Truth.
Good morning, People's Church. We're journeying through Nehemiah, and just to reset the context of Nehemiah, we're going to be looking at chapter 4, so if you have your Bibles, you can turn to chapter 4. We're going to be looking into that text in a few moments. I just want to refresh our minds as to what's taken place so far. The exiled people of the Holy Land have been brought back by God into Jerusalem. The first group to come back were under the leadership of Zerubbabel, and when Zerubbabel and that group of exiles returned, the first thing they did to rebuild the broken places of their lives was to restore altar worship in Jerusalem and to rebuild the temple of God in that city. Afterwards, after that was established, Ezra was the next to lead a group back, and he restored Torah. He started to teach people the word of God. And then God started to stir up the heart of Nehemiah in the citadel of Susa, cupbearer to the king, when he heard that the people were in disgrace because the walls of Jerusalem had been burned down. He was cut to the heart. And we looked at the first few chapters of Nehemiah already, where God lays a burden on his heart. He shares it before King Artaxerxes, and the king gives him all the resources he needs to rebuild the walls. We looked at chapter 3 and how Nehemiah rallies the people, and they see the evidence of God's hand at work to restore the broken walls. And in chapter 3, they start to labor at the work. All is going well. All is going according to plan. They can see the evidence of God's gracious hand upon Nehemiah and the people. But we need to be reminded that wherever God's work is advancing, we know that we have a very real adversary who wants to resist and frustrate the work of God taking place. And Nehemiah is about to run into that very reality. So before we dive into chapter 4 and look at some of the opposition that Nehemiah faces, I just want us to think of this verse and maybe lay it over top of all of Nehemiah chapter 4. It's found in 1 Peter chapter 5, and it says this: "Be alert and of sober mind. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, looking for someone to devour. Resist him, standing firm in the faith, because you know that the family of believers throughout the world is undergoing the same kind of sufferings." As we move into chapter 4, I want you to be thinking of that verse. Be self-controlled and alert. The 1984 NIV edition says that. Be self-controlled and alert. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, looking for someone to devour. Resist him, standing firm in the faith, because you know that your brothers throughout the earth are undergoing the same kind of suffering. Nehemiah is doing exactly what God's leading him to do, but he's about to have a run-in with the roaring lion. In chapter 4, verse 1, we read this: "When Sanballat heard that we were rebuilding the wall, he became angry and was greatly incensed. He ridiculed the Jews, and in the presence of his associates and the army of Samaria, he said, 'What are those feeble Jews doing? Will they restore their wall? Will they offer sacrifices? Will they finish in a day? Can they bring the stones back to life from those heaps of rubble, burned as they are?' Tobiah the Ammonite, who was at his side, said, 'What they are building, even a fox climbing up on it would break down their wall of stones.'" We need to understand who this Sambalat and Tobiah are. I just want to do a bit of an ancestry.com on them. I want you to understand their mindset and why they're so fiercely opposed to the Jewish nation reestablishing a presence in the city of Jerusalem and restoring walls of defense around them. What is these guys' story? Where do they come from? Why are they so angry and incensed that this would take place? Well, in order to appreciate that, we need to go back to Ezra chapter 4. When Zerubbabel entered into the land, the people of Samaria saw them restoring the altar worship and working to rebuild the temple. And when the northern tribes were exiled, the king of Assyria had brought people from all over his kingdom to resettle the region known as Samaria. And with it, they brought the worship of all of their gods from whatever nation they were brought from. But when they entered the land, wild lions were eating the people, and they thought God was against them. So they met with the king of Assyria and said, "We don't know what the God of this land requires of us. Send a priest who used to live here to teach us how to observe his commands so that we don't get eaten by lions." And sure enough, the king of Assyria sends in a priest to teach the people about Yahweh and the God of Israel. And so they learn about the God of Israel, his requirements, his laws, his decrees, how to worship him, and they simply add it to their worship. But they hold to all of the cultish practices that were evident in the nations from which they came. So they simply added the worship of Yahweh to their worship of Chemosh and all the other various gods that they came with. So when Zerubbabel and the other exiles start to restore the temple, these guys come in Ezra chapter 4 and they say, "Let us help you build because like you, we seek your God and have been sacrificing to him. Let us join you in restoring the altar of worship and rebuilding the temple." And Zerubbabel and the other leaders answer them harshly. Zerubbabel and them say to them, "You have no part with us in building a temple to our God. We alone will build it for the Lord, the God of Israel, as King Cyrus, the king of Persia, commanded us." Now, how do you think the Samaritans responded when Zerubbabel and the elders said, "You have no part with us, we're going to build this temple, and you are not going to be involved at all"? Now, the reason Zerubbabel and the Israel leaders are saying that is because of all the cultish practices that are going on within the Samaritan region. They were sacrificing their children to their gods. And Zerubbabel look at them and say, "We've just been exiled for the very cultish practices that these guys embody, and we don't want them involved in rebuilding the temple." And so when they answer them harshly, the people of Samaria set out to discourage them in their building efforts. They go on to try and make them afraid to go on building, and it sparks a decades-long campaign to frustrate their efforts. Sanballat and Tobiah's father and grandfather were some of those people that were answered harshly. So when Nehemiah shows up and starts to restore the walls of Jerusalem, Sanballat's dad and granddad's words are ringing in his ears, and he fiercely opposes Nehemiah's efforts because he does not want the Jewish state to advance. And so he starts to mock and ridicule him. Now, Sanballat would appear very spiritual. Sanballat's daughter was married to one of the sons of the high priest in Jerusalem. So Sanballat probably can talk spiritual talk, but when you look at what he's saying in the presence of the army of Samaria, he doesn't worship the God of Israel. He is its fierce opponent. It's like someone coming to the church and saying, "I worship Jesus just like you. I love Jesus." But upon closer inspection of their life, they're offering their children up in sacrifice to other gods. They're bowing down to idols. There's sexual promiscuity in their life. They're giving themselves to all kinds of sin. But they're saying, "No, no, no, I worship Jesus just like you." And you're like, "Yo, man, no, you don't." If that's all going on in your life. And you will have no part in establishing the worship here. That's what took place with Sanballat's grandfather. And so he's been carrying anger towards the Jewish people all these years. And when Nehemiah starts to rebuild, he fiercely opposes him, and it begins with ridicule. And it's an important reminder for us to realize that when we start to rebuild the broken places in our lives, when we start to restore that altar of worship, as we take step towards God's word and aligning in obedience to it, as the walls of defense start to be restored in our lives, we must know and realize that the enemy will seek to attack us when we're starting to take steps towards God. And oftentimes, his attacks start with ridicules and insults, because Sambalat says, "What are these feeble Jews doing? Can they actually even bring those stones back to life?" And Tobias standing beside him, and he said, "Look at that wall. Even if a fox climbs on it, it's going to fall down." The enemy will seek to discourage you, seek to ridicule you, seek to insult you. He will do whatever he can to get your focus off of rebuilding the walls, off of what God's called you to do, and onto the lies that he wants to spread into your mind and heart. He is called the father of lies for that reason. Maybe you're here this morning and you're in that place. Maybe the Sambalats of the world have been chirping in your ear. Sometimes those attacks even come from people in our own family who want to discourage us from walking out what God's called us to. Maybe Sambalat's been speaking into your life and saying, "You're so feeble. Look at what you're trying to do. Can there really be restoration in your life? Look at all that rubble. Look at those stones in your life, burned as they are. Do you really think God cares about you? And can God really bring life back to that part of your life?" Sambalat's always trying to spread lies into our minds. Jesus, on the day that he was baptized by John the Baptist in the desert, when the dove descends on him and the Holy Spirit descends on him in the form of a dove, heaven says to Jesus, "This is my son, whom I love, with him I am well pleased." But the very next verses, Jesus is led out into the desert to be tempted by the devil. And what you'll notice is every time the devil comes to tempt Jesus, he starts with the same statement: "If you are the Son of God, tell these stones to become bread. If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down. If you are the Son of God," Satan's trying to cast doubt into heaven's declaration. "You are my Son, whom I love, with you I am well pleased. Oh, really, if you are the Son of God, do so and so and such and such." So Sambalat is spreading his poison in the presence of the army of Samaria. He's sharing what he thinks of Nehemiah's work. He describes himself as someone spiritual, maybe even a worshiper of Yahweh, but by his actions, he's criticizing the very work that God called into existence. What does Nehemiah do in response? We see it in verse 4. He simply gets on his knees and he prays, "Hear us, our God, for we are despised. Turn their insults back on their own heads. Give them over as plunder in a land of captivity. Do not cover up their guilt or blot out their sins from your sight, for they have thrown insults in the face of the builders." When this threat is brought before Nehemiah, he simply gets on his knees and prays, and he says, "Hear us, O God, for we are despised. God, you're the one who tapped my shoulder in the citadel of Susa and laid this great work on me. God, you're the one who moved the heart of Artaxerxes and brought us back to the land to restore the walls. As we give ourselves to this work and this threat is mounting against us, we lay it before you, God. You take care of him. You watch over us. Lord, see what they're saying about us. They're not only insulting us, they're insulting you who has led us to do this great work." So Nehemiah simply lays it in God's hands, and we read in verse 6 that they continued to build the wall till all of it reached half its height, for the people worked with all their heart. So everybody just continues to focus on what God's calling them to do, continues to restore the walls, and then Sambalat and Tobiah, their ridicule starts to turn into rage. We see that in verse 7. When Sanballat, Tobiah, the Arabs, the Ammonites, and the people of Ashdod heard that the repairs to Jerusalem's walls had gone ahead and that the gaps were being closed, they were very angry. They all plotted together to come and fight against Jerusalem and stir up trouble against it. Their ridicule and taunts and mocking is now turning into a murderous threat and a rage against Jerusalem. Now, you have to understand, when you look at a map and compare it with the nations that are listed in verse 7, Jerusalem is in the heart of that, and then you have Samaria to the north, Ammon to the east, Ashdod to the west, and Idumea is the region of the Arabs. Jerusalem is surrounded by a hostile force. They have banded together and they are planning to attack and thwart the efforts of Nehemiah. Now, for us in Western society, sometimes this is very difficult for us to really appreciate because we've never faced physical persecution, many of us. I mean, when I became a Christian and I was working in a kitchen, the worst thing that I faced is that other chefs and other people in the kitchen would mock me for my faith. They would call me God boy or tell inappropriate jokes. They would say things that they knew it bothered me. They were trying to get a rise out of me, and I would always smile and just say, you know, God loves you or whatever. They tried to provoke me. They tried to insult me and ridicule me, but none of them tried to take a knife and stab me. None of them took a knife and stabbed my tires. None of them threatened physical violence upon me because we have laws in Canada that protect us from that action. But if I took Nehemiah chapter 4 and took the reality of being surrounded by their enemies and read this passage, say, in Pakistan, I might read it through a different lens. Be self-controlled and alert, for your enemy the devil prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. Resist him, standing firm in the faith, because you know that your brothers and sisters throughout the world are undergoing the same kind of suffering. Peter writes that to the church right before Nero starts to martyr Christians in Rome. And as we look at the world today, Christians are persecuted every day by family, by community, by countries. And so when we read these words, we need to remember that context means everything. Nehemiah and his colleagues are carrying out exactly what God's called them to do. They're restoring the broken places, and what started as ridicule and threat is now turning into imminent physical violence. And in verse 9, we see the people's response, "But we prayed to our God, and we posted a guard day and night to meet this threat." Consistently, this threat is spoken against the Israelites time and time again. They are surrounded by these hostile nations. And in verse 10, we read this. "The people in Judah said, 'The strength of the laborers is giving out, and there is so much rubble that we cannot rebuild the wall.' Also, our enemy said, 'Before they know it or see us, we will be right there among them and will kill them and put an end to the work.' Then the Jews who lived near them came and told us 10 times over, 'Wherever you turn, they will attack us.'" The threat of constant imminent danger is wearing on the people in Jerusalem. They're looking at the work and their strength is giving out. There's so much rubble that they have to work through, and just the task of rebuilding the broken places alone is a lot of exhaustion for them. But facing this threat and this hostile force around them is starting to weigh them down. It's starting to occupy their mind and slow the work down. And maybe you're in that place this morning. Maybe you're here this morning and you've been attempting to take steps with Christ and walk closer with God to rebuild some of the broken places of your life, but the strength of the laborers is giving out. You find yourself struggling. You look at your life and there's so much rubble, there's so much burnt stone to weigh through, and the enemy's voice is mocking you. You're so feeble. Can you really bring stones back to life? Do you really think you can experience victory in this part of your life? Nehemiah and his brothers and sisters are facing that moment, and it begs the question, how do we move forward when we are in this place, when our strength is giving out, when the threat is real, and everything's seemingly against us? How do we move forward in what God's calling us to do? I believe we find the answer in verse 13. Nehemiah says this, "Therefore I stationed some of the people behind the lowest points of the wall at the exposed places, posting them by families with their swords, spears, and bows." In verse 22, he says this, "At that time I also said to the people, 'Have every man and his helper stay inside Jerusalem at night, so they can serve us as guards by night and as workers by day.'" Nehemiah starts to gather the people together and have them stand in the vulnerable, exposed places. As the nations around them prepare to attack them, Nehemiah says, "We are stronger when we come together, and let us stand with one another in the gaps, stand with one another in the vulnerable spaces." And then Nehemiah does this in verse 14, as he has people banded together in the weak spots. In verse 14, he says this, "After I looked things over, I stood up and said to the nobles, the officials, and the rest of the people, 'Don't be afraid of them. Remember the Lord who is great and awesome, and fight for your families, your sons and your daughters, your wives and your homes.'" When the enemy is chirping, when the labor is giving out, when it's becoming too much to handle, we are reminded by Nehemiah chapter 4 that we are stronger together, and we need to remember the Lord our God who is great and awesome. And Nehemiah gathers these people and he bands them together and he says, in these weak places, in these vulnerable places, this feeble group will stand together and we will remember that it's not according to our strength. We will remember the Lord who is great and awesome. We will remember the Creator who breathed all of this into existence. We will remember that the Lord delivered us from our bondage and slavery to Pharaoh in Egypt. We will remember that God victoriously led us into the promised land in which we are now dwelling. We will remember Gideon, who faced a vast army with 300 men, but the Lord gave the victory. We will remember that David slew Goliath, even though on paper it looked like it was going to be a slaughter. We will remember that God stirred the heart of Nebuchadnezzar and made him a believer. We will remember that King Cyrus, before he was born, God declared that he would set us free and bring us back. We will remember that Artaxerxes has provided for us to go about rebuilding these walls. We will remember that the Lord is great and awesome. We come together to remember that if God be for us, who can stand against us? He who did not spare his own life, but laid it down willingly for us. We just gathered and remembered that reality when we took the Lord's Supper. So if you are here today and your strength is giving out, the work seems too heavy, too hard, there's hostile forces coming against you, I implore you to remember the Lord who is great and awesome. But I'm going to close with this one thought. Sometimes on a Sunday after I speak, people come up and they share the crisis they're in. They share the pain they're in. They share what's going on. They long for victory but are experiencing defeat. And inevitably, I ask them the same question every time. Do you know one mature Christian who walks with God and is journeying with you through this difficult time? Is there one person that can speak into your life and hold you up in that time that you're struggling through? And 10 out of 10 times, people who are experiencing deep crisis and defeat in their life always answer the same way. No, there isn't. There's nobody. And I say to them, that's where we're going to start. Because when we look at Nehemiah chapter 4, he calls the people together to the vulnerable, exposed places of the wall, and he says, we stand together. So if you are here and you're longing for strength and vitality and victory, you need to realize that we experience that in community. There is no solo Christianity. We are not meant to journey the Christian life alone. We do it together. Because what we see in this chapter is that they continue rebuilding the broken places because they band together. And you need to ask yourself, who is standing with me in the vulnerable, exposed places of my own life? Who is holding me up in prayer? Who's encouraging me? And who am I holding up? And who am I encouraging? Because we live this Christian life together and we remember the Lord great and awesome together. Because that is how we continue walking out the Christian life. We do it together.
To watch this message again, visit our website. Download transcripts, order DVDs and CDs, as well as our daily devotional, or sign up for our monthly newsletter. Online, you can sign up for podcasts. You can also join us on Facebook and YouTube.
This is Living Truth.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of His Spirit, washed in His blood. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story. Submission, all is at rest.